I'd like to welcome you to the Center for Bioengineering and Biotechnology's second, this is our second visionary lecture series speaker. We're very happy today to have Dr. Peter Singer. Okay, Peter Singer is the CEO of the Grand Challenges Canada program. I want to kind of walk through a little bit of why we established this lecture series. And there's really kind of two reasons. The first is we wanted to bring people who we really think are visionaries in the way that they're trying to change the world to you, particularly if they have some connection to biotech or biomedical engineering or bioengineering. But it's also twofold, so I want you to think a bit about that today, is that when I mean visionary, certainly we're bringing in people we think are visionaries, but we want to encourage you as well to expand your vision. So you can think of it possibly as double vision or maybe reciprocal vision. So as we spend this afternoon today, let's think about how we can also reach out and engage more in these areas. A little bit of logistics. So after Peter's talk, there's going to be some time for questions. We're going to ask that you wait for the microphone to come to you for the questions. We have two very nice volunteers at the back, just put up their hands, who have confirmed to run microphones between people. And I think that's all I need to say at this point. So I'd like to, we'll have two welcomes before the talk. So our first welcome will be from Dr. Pearl Sullivan, the Dean of Engineering. And our second welcome will be from Dr. Rohinta Medora, the Director of CG. Okay. So Dr. Sullivan, would you?
Thank you very much, Catherine, and welcome, everyone. First of all, I have to say, visionaries make a difference. You know, and I have to say, Dr. Singer, thank you so much for coming here today, but for also being a visionary more than 20 years ago, to think about the grand challenges that affect human beings, you know, on this planet, and what we need to do to improve for the lives of everyone. So, the Grand Challenges Award in Canada that was formed through your leadership together with Dr. Abdullah Dar has supported projects all across Canada. I had a wonderful meeting with Dr. Cynthia Goh from Department of Chemistry, University of Toronto just this week. And she said that without that program, so much of what the students want to do in the field of entrepreneurship and making it happen would not be possible without the grand challenges. So I'm sure Cynthia will join me to say thank you. And from University of Waterloo, we have received 6 awards. Some of the PIs of the awards are here: Dr. John Yao, Systems Design Engineering; Dr. Karim Karim, Electrical and Computer Engineering; Dr. Omar Ramahi, of Electrical and Computer Engineering; Dr. Shirley Tang of Chemistry; Dr. Cherie Paxunian, Civil and Environmental Engineering; and Dr. Michael Tam of Chemical Engineering. So, as you can see, engineers love to change the world, right? So I want to say thank you again for your vision and for making it happen, because the Grand Challenges is one of the awards that we look out for every year, and we bring it to the young professors who want to make a difference. So thank you, Catherine, and thank you, Rohan, for CG for supporting this. And I will now hand this back to Rohan. Thank you.
Thank you all. So thank you, Dean Sullivan. Thank you, Catherine Burns. The theme, I guess, for this afternoon's talk is going to be integration and innovation. And let me just spend 2 minutes introducing our speaker, my friend and colleague, Dr. Peter Singer, and why integration and why innovation. Innovation is a word that's used a lot, especially in this town. It happens to be in the title of the organization I run, the Center for International Governance Innovation. And it's one of those words that means all things to all people. It almost becomes plastic at some point. And innovation has different facets to it, right? I mean, it can be scientific advance, making a better widget. It can be competitiveness. You often talk about Finland being an innovative country. Why? And you know, Nokia is an innovative company. What does that mean? And then you've got social innovation. You know, microcredit is often held up as. And for something to be a good idea that is then well-researched, brought to market, and changes people's lives, that whole chain requires a vision of innovation that is much more integrated than we think of in our various disciplinary silos. And I think, and you know, Peter will tell us about this, that that is what drove the creation of Grand Challenges Canada, which very much is the vision of Peter Singer, going back now almost 10 years, perhaps slightly less. The idea being that we have so much to learn and so much to do in the area of global health. And how we go about doing it is a question of doing good research, good public policy, good dissemination, and everything in between. And so Grand Challenges Canada was created about 7 years ago as an enterprise of the Government of Canada. Peter Singer is the CEO of Grand Challenges Canada, and in many ways embodies what the vision here is. He himself has had an eminent career as a faculty member at the University of Toronto, involved in many public policy enterprises, including a very landmark study about 3 years ago on Canada's interventions globally in global health, and I think you chaired that particular one. He has a background in medicine, medical ethics, as well as business. So he himself embodies what we hope will become rooted in the way Canada comports itself both at home and overseas. So with that short introduction, Peter, over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Rohinton. Let me just start by saying that I'm not sure Grand Challenges Canada would have been possible without a colleague like Rohinton, who was at IDRC at the time and had a lot to do with its founding. So thank you, Rohinton. And very pleased to be here. I wanted to thank Catherine and in particular Christina, who's there in the for all the arrangements. And Dean, thank you very much for your kind words. You know, at the end of the day, it's a huge privilege to be able to serve your country and use innovation to improve humanity. And it's just as simple as that. And it's a privilege for me, and I think it would be a privilege for anybody in the room who was going down that path. So we're thrilled that we've been able to support, as you said, six innovations here. One of them is on diagnostics, John Yao. Three of them are on water, essentially, different types of filters or monitoring. One of them's on continuous delivery of oxygen, and one of them's imaging, which is the low-cost X-ray. But I had a good conversation with John at the beginning of this session, and would you be willing just to say again what you said to me, which was what has been, from your standpoint, the benefit of the work that you've done with your project? And this was one of our first projects in our diagnostics, and it just shows you the kind of catalytic effect that you can have when people actually want to lead like John did.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much, Peter, for being here today. Well, I work with a company in India. The company is called Big Tech. The company has been working on trying to diagnose pathogens in drinking water for a long time. So the CEO of the company visited Waterloo twice. I went to Bangalore to visit the company twice. So there has always been an intention to work together, but nothing really materialized until Grand Challenges and Peter came along and supported the project. So, and that was, like Peter said, it was one of the earlier projects, must have been 5-6 years ago. And the project was for a duration of 3 years. At the end of the third year, we actually have a functioning sample preparation device that's currently undergoing clinical trial in Bangalore. So in 2 years after the ending of the grant, we're still working strong together. I was telling Peter that without Grand Challenges Canada, you have two group of people on different side of the planet wanting to work together but never had the opportunity. and grand challenges provided the sort of the grant and the opportunity for us to do that, and it's still going strong today. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, John. And at the other end of the spectrum, a number of the projects I mentioned are very recent, so they may not have had their proof of concept results. But when they do, we get interested in scaling, including through commercial things, spin-off companies, and so on. And Kareem, you've got a terrific idea. Do you want to just share your idea and your experience? And we actually didn't talk before this, so I don't know what Kareem will say. I think we'll just start with a couple of these vignettes. Apologies that we won't go to everyone, so we don't go through six. But it would be interesting if you just shared your experience a little bit with...
So thanks very much, Peter. And it's very nice to see you again. So the original idea was building an X-ray imager to replace analog film in emerging and low-cost economies, right? And or I should say low-income countries. And that's what we did, actually. The money we received from Grand Challenges Canada, the Rising Stars Award, allowed us to build this proof of prototype. Now, to actually take this prototype and bring it into the market, that was a whole different challenge, and that's why we set up a startup company, KAA Imaging, to actually translate and help be the vehicle that would take the X-ray imager and now basically put it out into India and China and all of those countries.
And when you're hearing about these technologies, mm-hmm. I mean, think tuberculosis, a global scourge that both of these technologies implicate tuberculosis. Think pneumonia, which kills a million kids a year. I mean, there just isn't anything better than innovators in Canada and in low and middle income countries themselves pursuing bold ideas with big impact. And that's really what's at stake. And I thought the best place to start would be with a couple of stories here. That's my Twitter address, if you want to tweet or if you want to discuss by Twitter when we're done. But what follows from those two stories is actually the engagement of people here and the engagement of young people. We're at a point where our initial funding is winding down and our renewal funding is about to wind up. And so this is a great time to start thinking about engaging. You'll see at the end of the talk, one of the main lessons that I've learned is that if you tap into the creativity of young people in Canada, and they engage, amazing things can happen. There's a lot of social entrepreneurs throughout Canadian universities, and sometimes not in universities, who could engage, I think, more robustly with these kind of financing schemes. And at the end of the day, that's our goal. That increases lives saved and improved. It increases Canada's productivity. I mean, these are little examples that you heard, right? But that's the vision. And then more globally, you will know that last week at the United Nations adopted these 17 Sustainable Development Goals that on January 1st will replace the Millennium Development Goals. These are global goals that essentially align governments, academe, private sector, civil society towards comprehensive goals. They're actually much broader than the Millennium Development Goals, and they represent, underlying each of these tiles is a series of targets, very specific targets. When you're in an area like maternal newborn child health, as we are, or women, children's adolescent health, sometimes you'll have clusters that range across a variety of targets. So you see there's a sustainable goal there under good health and well-being, but you see issues relevant to the health of women and children, for example, in the gender empowerment goal, in the education goal, if you think about pre-K, in the agriculture nutrition goal, if you think about child's brain development, et cetera. So we are largely under three, but also working as a cluster across several because we're focused on global health. And I also wanted to point out number nine, which is industry, innovation, and infrastructure. If you get a bunch of governments together, they will come up with some pretty good targets, which you'd see if you dug under number nine. There's a technology bank, there's stimulation of innovation domestically in developing countries, there's stimulation of small and medium enterprise, there's some capacity building, research capacity building under there. But what I want to describe in this talk is a slightly different way of approaching global innovation. And essentially the vision, and I'll state it at the beginning and I'll state it at the end, and in the middle I'll try and show what we've actually been doing in Canada to help actualize that vision. The vision is that here you've got these sustainable development goals. They ain't going to be reached without innovation. Or put another way, innovation can accelerate the attainment of these sustainable development goals, including at the country level, because the global goals all need to resonate with what countries are doing. ODA itself, official development assistance, which is about $130 billion, is nowhere near enough to actually drive attainment of these goals. So two other sources of capital at least, private capital and domestic resources from governments in the developing world, which at the end of the day is the largest fund for innovation in the world to pull innovation, that's going to need to be implicated. But how do you actually make that system work? So imagine a vision like this. Countries support their own innovators at proof of concept, just like Canada is doing, India is starting to do, as I'll show you. Countries support their own innovators at proof of concept, but then you need to be able to see all those innovations that have arisen anywhere in the world. And there's a platform starting to develop called the Exchange, which hasn't gone live yet, that where any project in innovation that's funded could be up there as an idea. You could see it, you could see its results. But then you need to go from 200 innovations in a segment, be it an aspect of clean energy or pneumonia, to say, well, what are the 5 or 10 most promising ones? You have to be able to curate those innovations. And you need to then be able to take the most promising ones, link them amongst traditional funders like Grand Challenges Canada, Gates Foundation, USAID, but also where appropriate, bring in companies, including multinationals, bring in governments, and ultimately move some of those innovations to private investors who want to do impact investing, for example, through investment banks or asset managers, but don't really have a trustworthy pipeline of innovations they support. That's curation and brokering, the things I just described, in something you might think about as an innovation marketplace. And for Every Woman, Every Child, for Women, Children, and Adolescent Health, that was launched last Saturday by the Secretary General. But then it's not enough to push a string, because everything I described was up to about a $3 million life cycle investment or a little bit more. No innovation has ever scaled if there hasn't been real demand and financing from consumers. And so you can link these innovations with some of the larger global facilities, like the Global Finance Facility for Every Woman, Every Child, a $3.5 billion facility for women and children's health, and start to make that link. And at the same time, you need to be able to measure the results of those innovations. So you need to be able to say that if Karim develops his thing, it will save the lives of 3 million people and improve the lives of 10 million people, or similarly with the sample prep, or similarly with each individual innovation, and you need to roll those up. That's not traditionally the way we think about innovation, with impact at the end and being quite precise about how we measure that impact. Of course, you have to model it, because the impact of innovation comes in the future. So you have to think about, for example, what might happen out to 2030, but that's my vision. Of an ecosystem where you've got Grand Challenges organizations in different countries supporting innovators, a place you can see all that innovation, choose the best ones, broker partnerships around it, including domestic governments and the private sector, get into the pull of the market and of public markets, because sometimes you have a failure of ability to pay, and then measure results and lives saved. And this is very much, these goals are very much on measurement. So that's the vision. And I'll come back to that at the end. We'll talk throughout about Canada's role in that vision and about how you can play a part and about how that vision might unfold. But I want to suggest that that vision is more tractable and more robust than a technology bank plus a target on SMEs plus a target on essentially research capacity development in low and middle income countries alone. It fits together, and different pieces of that vision are already coming into play. So that's the visionary part of the visionary lecture. And now let's look at some concrete examples. This is a trip I took to Bihar, which is the poorest province of India. And I'm in this little room with Carly Silver, who's in the background there, who works in Grand Challenges Canada. It's a few hours outside of Patna, the capital. And the room starts filling up with people. And I say, who are all these people? Well, these were all people whose lives had been saved through an innovation that was funded by Canada on visceral leishmaniasis. Visceral leishmaniasis, or Kala-Azar, is a very rare, but not in this part of the world, neglected disease. And the bottom line is, it's very hard to tell whether somebody has Kala-Azar. And if you identify somebody, you can treat them with a $70 single dose of amphotericin and they live. And if you don't identify them, they die. So these were all people who'd been identified through this project, through this innovation, and who lived but would otherwise be dead, including those two girls on the right who want to be teachers when they grow up. So what was the innovation? It wasn't that complicated. It combined taking the RK38 or 39 or whatever it's called test for visceral leishmaniasis that had been previously validated on serum and validating it on blood so the testing could be done deep in the village. The training of 1,000 community health volunteers so they could live in the village and identify cases. And a little bit of research around the transmission and the contact tracing, which helped the whole system move deep into a village, save these lives. And it led to the reduction of VL, or Kala-Azar, levels to elimination levels in four 250,000 person districts, and then in India. And then when the Indian Prime Minister came, Canada and India announced joint funding to extend this innovative project, which, by the way, is based at the Indian Council for Medical Research in Bihar and McGill University. We have a visceral leishmaniasis expert who's Canadian there, works at WHO, extend it to the next 5 of 20 remaining elimination districts. So this is innovation with impact. This is another example that I want to give you. I'm starting with some concrete examples. This was a trip I took to Haiti, and both these people, the young mother and also the middle-aged woman there, had had seizures. And seizures, epilepsy, it was unclear. People don't know what that is in rural Haiti. These folks had been stigmatized as being possessed. But we funded a project through Zami LaSante, which is a Haitian version of Partners in Health, that essentially identified lay workers to go to church, to go to various places, and identify people who were having seizures, bring them in, put them on simple treatments, low-cost treatments. And these were both people whose lives had been hell for 10, 20-year period because they were having seizures and they were stigmatized, who were then identified by this innovative, this is a social innovation, it's really health system delivery, this innovative project, identified, put on a simple, low-cost treatment, and now their lives are very fulfilling and meaningful. And it also shows you that improving a life, it's not quite like saving a life, but you can get a lot of benefit out of lives improved in addition to lives saved. And when you meet these folks, it's a huge privilege. And this is thousands of people who've been screened. And it's a broader project that deals not just with seizures, but also depression and other mental health conditions. And 2,000 to 3,000 of them have had their lives improved. So you're starting to see real impact. Now notice that it's primarily the social innovations, because Grand Challenges Canada has been around for about 5 years, that are showing impact at the 5-year mark, because the technological innovations take a little bit longer and we like to have a balanced portfolio. This is the last example of a social innovation. This is chlorhexidine in Nepal. This was done with our partners through Saving Lives at Birth, Gates Foundation, Norway, the UK, USAID, and Grand Challenges Canada. So chlorhexidine is a common component of mouthwash. And it had been known before this project that if you put chlorhexidine on the umbilical cord of a newborn baby, their infection rate drops because the infection enters through the umbilical cord, and newborn infection is a key cause of newborn death. And something like 40% of children die in the newborn period, which is between 0 and 30 days, of the 6 million or so children who die under the age of 5. But what hadn't been known is how to deliver this to the point of use. So again, this is social innovation that trained 1,000 people to actually be delivering the chlorhexidine to mothers in Nepal to have it applied after birth. And this project would have reached over 1 million people by now and saved, and this project alone would have saved over 7,000 lives of newborns, if you model it out. So these are the kinds of social innovations that you're really seeing being quite effective already at the 5-year mark. One more example of a social innovation. This is a social enterprise in a slum in Nairobi, and that's Israel. And this is about getting kids in the first 1,000 years of the first 1,000 days of life, and in pre-K, stimulating them. This is kind of Fraser Mustard does global health. 1 in 3 children worldwide never reach their full potential because of threats to their brain from health things like nutrition, lack of parental stimulation, and child protection things, being a child soldier, et cetera. And this is a social enterprise in Nairobi that's trying to get at that. That's Israel, who was very quiet, cried when I left, but he will be stimulated through this program, as you see in the top right. The bottom right is the franchise model. So often in the slum, when other people go to work, their kids are left with one of the women, and they kind of have an informal daycare setting. Well, the idea of this social franchise is to use the kind of quality standards that you see in the top right, link with this group, and show and improve the quality of stimulation and education to that group on a revenue-based model that's sustainable. So a really exciting type of social franchise. We also support technological innovations. This was another one through Saving Lives at Birth, the Odon device. First innovation in assisted vaginal delivery in a couple of 100 years. Obstructed and delayed labor, one of the top 3 causes of maternal illness and maternal death around the time of delivery. Think forceps, but this isn't forceps. This is a little balloon that goes over the head of the baby that delivers the baby down the birth canal. Innovation developed by an Argentinian car mechanic who, you know, saw a party trick of a wine cork in a bottle and kind of extrapolated from there, which shows you that innovation can come from anywhere. And the handoff was to BD, which is a Fortune 500 company, very significant multinational that's taken this and developed it. This particular innovation was on Jeopardy. So you actually know you've really made it when you get to be a question on Jeopardy. This is a Canadian company, LGT Medical, an anesthesia. So, you know, 1 million kids die of pneumonia every year, and you need to be able to measure their blood oxygen levels to see how sick they are and to monitor treatment, including oxygen treatment. There's one innovation in the group that's continuous monitoring of oxygen delivery and modifying it, so that's close to this one. An anesthesia professor, by the way, not to mention that 50% of the surgeries in Africa are done without monitoring of blood oxygen level in anesthesia. A professor at the University of British Columbia comes up with the idea of putting this saturation monitor on a cell phone, spins it out into a company called LGT. We helped support the proof of concept. We've also helped support the company. And so now you've got a company that is moving along, got an innovative technology for a problem that could tackle a million lives a year. That's not to say it's going to save 1 million lives a year. You have to be careful with your modeling and with your assumptions, but this is a critical gap in innovation. So an example of a Canadian company moving along, and I could list 5, 6, 7 Canadian companies, 10 social enterprises that Grand Challenges Canada has helped to support. Kareem is a good example. That example was a good example, as was the first one. So far, really what I've tried to do is say innovation is needed to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, and here's a vision for how that could occur. Easier said than done, but it's not impossible to do. Secondly, I've tried to give you some concrete examples, of innovations here at the University of Waterloo and encourage your engagement, and B, of innovations around, and tried to illustrate that innovation really can save and improve lives in the developing world. And I've given you several concrete examples. Now what I'd like to do is go back 10 years to the point that Rohinton was talking about, to say, how did all this start, and provide a little historical perspective very quickly, catch back up to the present and go from there, and leave lots of time for discussion and questions. So 100 years ago, David Hilbert had this thing called Grand Challenges in Mathematics that stimulated mathematicians to keep solving Hilbert's problems for 100 years. That method really wasn't used again until about 2002. When Bill Gates said, I want to use Hilbert's method of stimulating using a grand challenge and stimulating innovation in global health. And that then resulted in the 2003 launch of the Grand Challenges in Global Health. And I was minding my own business in late 2002. We'd just written a paper in Nature Genetics about top 10 biotechnologies in global health. And I got a call from these colleagues at the Gates Foundation who said, hey, the methods that you used in that paper could be helpful for us in helping to identify what the grand challenges are. I found myself in a small unmarked office in Washington in 2003 with Harold Varmus, who was a Nobel laureate and had just finished heading the NIH, Elias Zerhouni, who was the current head of the NIH, some of the senior folks from Gates. And we started to think about how one might design these grand challenges. Long story short, we did some technical work with Abdullah, who was mentioned, and a research fellow, Tara Acharya, and out comes 14 grand challenges in 2003, and what ultimately was about $500 million in these grand challenges classic things. These were very technologically oriented by and large, very infectious disease oriented by and large, kind of top down, $20 million max, $10 million average grant size, didn't really have the bubbling up ability of reaching out to graduate students, et cetera, which a few years later, by about 2007, 2008, I joined the scientific advisory committee of this, led to the advent of the Grand Challenge Explorations Program, which now is launched every 6 months with three or four topics from the Gates Foundation. And you should look for this at grandchallenges.org. They've had over 50,000 applications from 180 countries, made over 1,000 phase one awards of $100,000 at proof of concept, and over 50, that number's probably much larger by now, projects at phase two, which tends to be about $1 million in terms of the follow-on funding. And you'll see that we've used the same type of gradation in Grand Challenges Canada. So this is a little snapshot, obviously doesn't get to the bottom, of what the first Grand Challenges organization post David Hilbert, namely the Gates Foundation, did. They launched other challenges, et cetera, but this gives you a little bit of historical perspective. The third one was USAID, which is a $20 billion a year development agency in the United States. And what they did was launch Grand Challenges across different sectors, always with partnerships. So you see, they started with saving lives at birth, and so did we, because we do that together. I gave you that example when I was talking about the Odon device. But look at the other ones they launched. All children reading, securing water for food, power and agriculture, making all voices count, which is a kind of democratic voting grand challenge, which shows you that you can stimulate innovation against any problem, and fighting Ebola, which is the one where a wedding dress designer contributed to the design of a spacesuit, protective gear, personal protective equipment that was ultimately developed by, I think, Hopkins, and is moving forward through that one. So they've got some topic-focused challenges, and USAID really made two contributions to this movement. One is to show how it can spread across sectors, and secondly, to show how you can do it really quickly in response to a global challenge. On the other side, like Gates and its Grand Challenge Exploration, and as you'll see, like us, they launched something called Development Innovation Ventures, which ultimately has turned into the Global Innovation Fund, which is very open. Any idea, any sector, send it to them, has a low chance of success, but it's an open platform. So they have a balance in their strategy between defined challenges and an open innovation platform. And you'll see that all three of these organizations kind of did that strategic balance or reached that place themselves. But again, in addition to the grand challenges in global health, you should be looking at these development innovation ventures as a source of funding. And the Global Innovation Fund in particular is in startup mode, which is always a good time. There's a 99% chance that if you send them an idea, it won't get funded, a 1% chance that it will, and you just have to keep going for it. And it's as simple as that. But it's a good source for any sector, any idea to send it in. And it's open now. Grand Challenges Canada is the third anchor partner, if you will, in the Grand Challenges movement. It was actually second after Gates. Canada was the first country in the world to launch a Grand Challenges program for development innovation. Ours is with IDRC and CIHR, so there's a little consortium of groups. We support bold ideas with big impact in global health. We're funded by the Government of Canada. The initial tranche of funding was $235 million. We've supported over the last 5 years 700 innovations in 80 countries. In Canada, 226 innovations totaling 40 million, because our primary customers are innovators in low and middle income countries. Two-thirds of the funds have gone to innovators in the developing world, which I just mentioned. 43% of the funds have gone to women principal investigators, which we're actually pretty proud of when you compare it with prevalence in engineering schools, and we track that closely. So far, you know, innovation is a 10-15 year game, and most of the projects started in year two and three. Like the ones I mentioned, most of them started last year. But so far, we know we've saved about 8,700 lives across the projects and improved about 150,000. By the end of 2016, we estimate, which is when most of these initial projects will be done, estimate saving about 1.5 million, saving and improving. But by 2030, because remember, the benefits of innovation are in the future, we're projecting about 3 million lives saved and 35 million lives improved just from this initial investment. And you have to track it long enough, you have to model it, and you have to track it long enough to validate your models. So that's a little bit about Grand Challenges Canada. Going one level of detail down, about 50% of our funds have gone into the targeted challenges, saving lives at birth, saving brains, and global mental health. We're one of the top three funders of global mental health in the world, innovation in low and middle income countries. And about 50% have gone into our STARS program, which is the open innovation platform. And most of the ones we heard about here from Waterloo are in that STARS platform. So strategically, every group has gone to kind of 50-50 targeted challenges, open innovation platform. Our funds, I don't know if this was on the previous slide, is also about 50-50 proof of concept, creating a pipeline where it didn't exist, $100,000 to $250,000 grants, and then selecting one of 10 of those, say, to transition to scale with an additional $1 million, often in the form of non-grant finance, loans, convertible debt, repayable grants, equity, and so on. So there's a 50-50 proof of concept transition to scale, 50-50 strategic targeted challenges open innovation platform. We tended to veer early on to more support to low and middle income country innovators than the other two groups, but they're both heading very much in that direction now. And you see these three groups working very closely together, jointly in partnership across a whole range of programs. The big surprise for me, to be honest, was how the model spread. So in 2003, I don't think any of us expected the model to spread beyond us to other countries. But what we found happening around 2011, 2012, is the model spreading around the world. And this is an example just from the last year's Grand Challenges meeting in, last year's Grand Challenges meeting just got to get rid of that now. Can somebody get rid of that for me, or do I have to push a button or something? There you go. That's last year's Grand Challenges meeting in Seattle, 2014. You see in the middle Bill and Melinda, and then to his to Bill's right is Raj Shah, who was the administrator of USAID. To Raj's right is Alain Baudet, who was the head of CIHR representing Canada there, and this he's on our board at Grand Challenges Canada. To Melinda's left is the Secretary of Science in Department of Health, Government of Brazil. To his left is the former head of the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. And to his left is Glenda Gray, who heads the Medical Research Council in South Africa. And each of these organizations has a Grand Challenges organization working in a loose network with each other, co-funding things. Like I mentioned in that Indian Prime Minister's visit where we co-funded the visceral leishmaniasis and other projects, and so on. In addition to those ones, Grand Challenges Canada has taken a particular interest in helping Peru launch a Grand Challenges Peru, the government of Israel launch a Grand Challenges Israel. Imagine if you could unleash Israeli innovation in a systematic manner against developmental challenges in the world. And the government of Thailand launch a Grand Challenges Thailand. This is the former Deputy Prime Minister of Thailand, responsible for innovation and other things, who was on the original Grand Challenges Scientific Advisory Board. And of course, the issue in Thailand is you get the idea to spread to the whole ASEAN, which is 10 countries, tons of people, et cetera, et cetera. So the idea is spreading. So you can see the spread of the Grand Challenges idea. Now let's just go to a problem that all these groups are having, which is scaling. You know, 5 years ago, I think it's fair to say there was not a robust pipeline of innovation in many of these areas, especially not from innovators in low and middle income countries. For that matter, to my way of thinking, even not from Canadian innovators in this area, because global health in Canada was very much a public health policy thing 5 years ago. Nothing the matter with that. Public health policy is important. But think about the role, for example, of engineering schools in achieving global health with some of those examples. It's huge. And I think it's fair to say that engineering schools had not been really engaged by domestic Canadian institutions in global health, global challenges. So now I think we're at the point where there is starting to be a robust pipeline of innovations at proof of concept, but what we don't have is really the scaling. Sometimes it's kind of a pilotitis. Now, the pipeline does need to be refreshed in various segments, and I'll come back to that in a second. So I'm not saying the pipeline's perfect. But the real difficulty is actually taking a project like Karim's and then really transitioning it to scale with more investment, making that company successful, and then getting to the point where the market picks it up. And by the way, when I say market, could be a private market. You could be selling it individually for people. Could be a public market. Could be a government buying this. So I'm not differentiating in terms of private and public funding. I'm really talking about either. But that's the problem now, and that's illustrated by this picture that kind of points out that the scaling ladder is missing some rungs. And this is a challenge for innovation, I think, right across the world. What are we doing about that challenge? We've just launched, or actually the Secretary General last Saturday, or a couple of Saturdays ago, launched the Global Strategy for Women, Children, Adolescent Health, which is underneath Every Woman, Every Child, which is underneath those sustainable development goals that I showed you, or at least the ones related to women, children, and adolescents. And in his speech, the Secretary General launched the Every Woman, Every Child Innovation Marketplace. What is the Every Woman, Every Child Innovation Marketplace? It's actually what I told you before. It's a way of finding all the proof of concept stuff funded by anybody and having it on a single data platform so you can identify it. Then the innovation marketplace picks up with curation in a particular segment, like pneumonia, like maternal deaths, like child development, like diarrhea, like breastfeeding. You know, identify how many innovations there are around the world in that area, and what are the five most promising, not only based on their projected impact, but also based on the qualities of the team, the entrepreneurial capabilities, the business plan, the future funders, the partners, et cetera. So curating that and then brokering deals amongst the groups like Gates and Grand Transcan, et cetera, bringing in multinationals who want to be participating and can help to scale as scaling partners. Some of the work we've done with Karim, for example, has been introducing him to different multinationals relevant to his innovation. And then ultimately, bringing in domestic governments, so these can be done on the platform of a country, which is ultimately where innovations have to live, and then even high net worth individuals in that impact investing piece. So that's the space the innovation marketplace is trying to fill, and that's kind of a move forward in scaling models in the context of this problem, which is scaling gets stuck mostly because it's siloized among those organizations, and there's no systematic way to bring these public and private actors together to really work together to move innovations forward. You do it on an ad hoc basis, but that's a very inefficient market, and the idea here is to create a more efficient market where this can happen in a more systematic manner. So what are some of the lessons that we've learned in Grand Challenges Canada over the last 5 years, or as Rohinton was saying, more than 5 years? Well, firstly, our founder, Joe Rotman, said right from the beginning, we need to have an integrated view of innovation. We need to support science and technology, social innovation, business innovation, financial innovation, and we need to see them come together in integrated innovation. That visceral leishmaniasis example I gave you is a fantastic example. The RK39 blood test validation, that's technological innovation. It's not quite as core or deep as what Karim's doing, for example, but that's a technological step. The training of the 1,000 ASHA workers, the 1,000 volunteers, that social innovation. So you're bringing these things together. We've also done some financial innovation. I won't bore you with it, but we were the anchor investor. Canada was the anchor investor through Grand Challenges Canada in a $108 million venture fund called the Global Health Investment Fund that was designed by JP Morgan, risk guaranteed by Gates in Sweden, and is now in the process of investing to bring global health innovations across the finish line. And the financial innovation there is the risk guarantee, so you don't lose all your money, and that brings more investors in. We're starting to look at social impact bonds, and I can discuss in the discussion period, if anyone's interested in that, we can talk about how that's working. But essentially, integrate the types of innovation. Secondly, you know, it's called the Development Innovation Fund and not the Development Research Fund for a reason. We've applied VC principles to this, and when I say innovation, I'm really talking about the overall approach. And in particular, the overall approach of funding a big pipeline at proof of concept, where the question is really, is this a cool idea and could it work? That's the question these five groups answered. When we fund a transition to scale, and by the way, we do a peer review certified, done by CIHR, but it's been modified a little bit to have a science and technology innovator, a social innovator, and a business innovator, and it's done online, and it's a wholesale business. We've done almost 500 of these stars. We just want to get a big pipeline going in the stars. We don't worry that much about it. We want the pipeline of innovation to go. At transition to scale, it's completely different. The question is not, is this a cool idea and could it work? The question is this an entrepreneur that can go all the way? You know, when they get kicked in the face and they're bleeding on the floor, they'll dust themselves off and get up and keep going. Because that's what it takes to be a real entrepreneur. Do they have smart partners who will not only invest money, we always match at this point, but also participate in the business, participate in the public health model to make it a success? Do they have a sustainability plan? We're not interested in models that the government of Canada has to support forever. We're interested in what happens when the last public dollar is spent, and have we catalyzed a business? An impact first business, because we also don't care in huge financial returns. That's a means to an end. We care about the impact more than the investment. Have we got a public health model, like in mental health, that's likely to be picked up by a domestic government? That's really the question. And that's the question at transition to scale. Is this an entrepreneur who can succeed and all those other things I mentioned? And the review is completely different. It's informed by a CIHR review. But essentially, we've mimicked venture capital and set up an investment committee, which is a committee of our board, that has venture capitalists and social innovators on it to look at those questions of scaling impact and sustainability of the different innovations. Scaling models, I mean, it's obvious, should be obvious by now, that all the public resources in the world, the $130 billion of ODA, official development assistance, are not adequate to actually solve the problems that I showed you on the first slide in the Sustainable Development Goals. It's not even adequate to solve women and children's health problems. And so you need to be able to bring in private finance, you need to be able to bring in domestic governments really to solve that, and we need better scaling models like the Every Woman, Every Child Innovation Marketplace. Embracing failure. You know, we're okay with innovations failing. It's okay to fail, but we want those failures to be fast and cheap, and we want to learn from them. And so that's why we set up the universe as I described, with lots of proof of concept where we're putting $100,000 at risk, and much fewer, much more selective, 1 in 10, 7% transitioning to scale. And by the way, you know, we know that last time I looked, and we need to do a little bit of cleaning of these numbers, but about 65% of the stars get to proof of concept. 61% the hypothesis is confirmed. 4% the hypothesis is disconfirmed. 35% don't get to proof of concept, which is the failure of execution we want to decrease. And if that 4% to 61% is really true, we're probably not taking enough risks. So that's the stars. We also know, if you look at them, that 7% are scaled by us in partnership with others to date. Remember, this is an unfolding number. But 9% are scaled by others, which was a big learning. If you create the pipeline, they will come without participation of Grand Challenges Canada. So that's very interesting. You know, to take one example, ChipCare, a company we funded at Proof of Concept, it was an HIV diagnostic test, and then we funded them again, matching an angel investor. 3 years later, had a Series A financing of, I think, about $5 million without our participation. And that is what counts as success, when you've actually catalyzed something that you don't need to continue to fund. But this idea of failure is very much a cultural issue. And we really need to, I'm sure here at Waterloo, you feel that it's okay to fail. It is okay to fail. You just need to be able to fail in the right way. And it's very hard for us to talk about failure, but failure is good. You can't innovate without failure. You know that film, Meet the Robinsons, the Disney film? That's my favorite film, where they're sitting around the dinner table and the family says, congratulations to Lewis for his brilliant failure. And you can think about this whole Grand Challenges Canada platform as a way of managing the risk of innovation in a sensible way that's providing value for money in the public investment. That's really, most fundamentally, what the Grand Challenges platform is about. Partnerships, obviously, are key. Our chairman said you can't achieve anything without partnerships. We partner at the program level, as you've seen. We partner at the organizational level with the Grand Challenges Network. We partner at the project level. We don't fund things that transition to scale without smart partners. That's incredibly critical, and not just money. It's the angel investor who provides money and then becomes the chair of the board of the company and helps the company thrive. These are examples of smart partnerships. We focus on results. You know, it's amazing how much in innovation we focus on the bright, shiny baubles. That doesn't matter. What matters is projecting yourself 5, 10, 15 years into the future and seeing what kind of innovation, what kind of impact you can get off that innovation. So we've gotten deeply into modeling, projecting, measuring results. We had very relatively precise modeled numbers for lives saved and improved. And in fact, we're now slowly getting to the point where every time an investment comes to our investment committee, we have an estimate of by 2030, here's how many lives it'll be saving and how many lives it'll be improving. And in lives improved, this is what we mean. Is it use of eyeglasses? Is it use of a toilet? Is it receiving mental health services? What does that actually mean? This is the kind of modeling that ultimately you could use to compare different platforms of funders and see where you're actually getting results in innovation. But I think the implications for us are focus on the results. You know, innovation is the highway, impact is the destination. And if you really believe that, you have to measure and model results. And the reason you have to model them is because the results of innovation come in the future. They come 5 years in the future if you're a social innovation. They come 10 years in the future if you're a technology developer. And they, it will take Karim about 10 years. They can come 15 years in the future if you're going back into discovery science and you're developing a vaccine. The Ebola vaccine, for example, funded by PHAC, that's a 15-year story. The meningitis vaccine in North Africa developed by PATH, that's a 15-year story. So you have to understand the timelines of innovation as well. And then finally, something we haven't really been able to get into, which is the potential for reverse innovation. Many of the examples that we fund would have fantastic domestic application, but we haven't been able to focus sufficiently. We've kind of nurtured that along, but haven't been able to do that as systematically as we might have liked. So back to this slide on the goals, and to end again with the vision. So when I presented this at the beginning, you might have said, oh, that's kind of weird, you know, how can you actually achieve that vision? But what you, I hope, will see is that innovation actually can power the attainment of some of these sustainable development goals, that there are some moves afoot by Gates, by USAID, by us, by private investors, to move towards an ecosystem that makes a lot of sense where that can actually happen. Countries supporting their own innovators, being able to see all the innovations in one place so you can figure out which ones are the most promising in a transparent way as a funder. You can broker partnerships amongst different funders and amongst public and private funders, including private investors, to move these things along to the point where actually they can be purchased. Because no innovation ever scaled without demand, and at the end of the day, you have to be able to measure the results you've achieved, and that cycle can start again. And Canada can play a significant role in that cycle of innovation powering sustainable development goals, because we've already started to do so. And that's my core message. Of course, nothing happens without a great team and without the support of the Government of Canada. You can almost think about this as a most fundamentally an issue in global governance. This is a way to promote innovation across the world to tackle global challenges. And in some ways, that's what Canada is stimulating, as well as the very specific examples I've brought you of actual people who are benefiting. And I guess maybe the last thing I leave you with, and then we'll have the discussion, is the thing I do that I enjoy the most is to meet the people who've benefited from innovations. When I actually get to go out in the field and meet those two girls who want to be teachers, who are alive, and they'll be fine, but they would be dead if it wasn't for that innovation financed by Canada, done by somebody at McGill and somebody at ICMR. You know, when I meet those people in Haiti who would be scared and stuck in their rooms, locked in their rooms, but now are living a full life because they're on anti-seizure medicines and their epilepsy has been diagnosed, and over and over and over again. That is the greatest privilege that anyone can have. And that's the privilege that each and every one of you can have in a much deeper way on your specific innovation if you think about the impact that it can have and think about how it can serve some of the world's poorest people. You know, today's Nobel Prize was awarded for ivermectin and artemisinin. And it's fantastic to see a Nobel Prize that's focused on discoveries that have saved and improved the lives of so many of the world's poorest people. Ivermectin being river blindness, onchocerciasis, and artemisinin being a key frontline treatment for malaria, which not only kills people, including kids, but significantly damages kids with severe malaria. They never reach their full potential, at least a good minority of the time if they've had a good going, serious bout of malaria. So it's terrific to see even that deep scientific recognition of the ability of innovation, of science, to have this kind of global impact. Canada can have a very significant role in this. It already is having a role through the support of the Government of Canada. And you can have a significant role. And that's my key message. Thank you very much. And I think now we have some time for some questions and discussion. So fire away.
I'm just going to remind people to wait for the microphone to come to you so we can hear your questions.
Thank you, Peter. That was a very moving presentation. Thank you very much. The question I have for you has to do with your ideas on sustainability, and particularly involving the private sector. And the reason I ask this is because it has been the experience of many aspiring entrepreneurs that it's very difficult to attract investment for a drug or a device or whatever that's going to be marketed in the developing world. The reason being that the profit margin is not high. So for example, if you go to Wall Street or even to Bay Street, or if you go to some of the big drug companies and you have an idea for a therapeutic that has huge application in the developing world, they shy away from it because they don't see the profit margin. So how does that square with your model?
Yeah, terrific question, and just a few quick responses. One is that's shifting a little bit, even as a matter of corporate social responsibility, as kind of companies sign on to global goals as they did last week. But corporate social responsibility doesn't scale. It has to be core to the company's business model. And that's where shared value comes in. There's a lot of thinking, and this is led by Michael Porter at Harvard, that selling a few things with big margins to relatively small amounts of people is maybe not as good a business model as selling stuff with much smaller margins to lots and lots and lots of people. So companies are starting to think about the other 4 billion people in the world as a very significant market, not one where you can get the margins, but as a real area of growth.
But many of them can't afford to pay anything.
Not really so, actually. If you bring the price down low enough, they can afford to pay, even in the midst of the slums. You can pay for, 10 cents for a little package of soap. This was the classic example as opposed to $2 for a bar of soap. So some of this is how the thing is packaged. There is purchasing power amongst the poor. Now, in the cases where there isn't, and or where you need to supplement it, you do have global finance facilities like the Global Finance Facility for Every Woman, Every Child. That's $3.5 billion with $800 million of grants and the rest being IDA loans through the World Bank. So there are finance facilities in climate. There's $15 billion sitting in. So there's supplemental financing. We do need to start thinking about these things as shared value markets. We need financial innovations that are bringing. And these things are very real. They're actually happening. I mean, many of the examples I gave you were companies picking up some of these things because they saw a market. BD did not pick up the Odon device only because it wanted to be charitable. It picked up the Odon device because it knew it could drive the manufacturing cost down with this innovation to the point where they could make money if they had enough support from public finance in the development process, which is one of the things that's happening through the Every Woman, Every Child marketplace. So there's a balance of these things on the finance side that actually does lead to viable markets. Think about this: what is the innovation that's changed more than anything else? The cell phone in East Africa. You know, tons of people have cell phones. You can afford cell phones even if you're poor. And yes, at the very bottom of the pyramid, maybe you don't have any purchasing power, and that's the example of ivermectin and river blindness, today's Nobel Prize. So for the last 30 years, 20 years or whatever, Merck has been donating ivermectin, and then of course the costs are in the distribution, and has made huge gains on river blindness, but then along comes the Global Health Investment Fund, and get this, this is an example of innovative finance. One of its known public investments is actually in a drug that is like ivermectin but needs to be given less frequently. The idea is that it can accelerate by 6 to 8 years the elimination of river blindness. What's the financial payoff? It's actually through priority review vouchers. So priority review vouchers are awarded by the FDA to a company that registers a drug, in this case the one we're talking about. And they can be transferred. There's a secondary market in priority review vouchers. And so that is actually the payoff in this impact investment fund for this drug, which is oriented at the very poorest people in the world, the billion people with neglected tropical diseases. And by the way, when we did that deal, the value of priority review vouchers on the secondary market, or when the Global Health Investment Fund did that deal, the value of priority review vouchers on the secondary market was $50 million. And the most recent priority review voucher to sell, albeit it's a very thin market, over the summer was something like $360 million. So here's an example of a drug that's oriented to the poorest people that can accelerate a social impact, where through an interesting financial engineering model, essentially, of priority review vouchers, it can be extremely profitable for the Global Health Investment Fund and for the company that is developing it. So whether it is corporate social responsibility, which is okay, charity's good, but it's not sufficient to scale, whether it's through shared value, which is really where most companies are going in terms of large markets, low volumes, whether it's through something else I should have mentioned, dual markets, many of the investments we have can be sold in the South and in the North at higher margins. Whether it is through, at the end of the day, you know, financial engineering examples like the priority review voucher example I gave you, the markets are starting to work better, even in the very poorest segments. And we have to just take that outlook and go, because the only other alternative is to say, poor people will never be able to afford anything. We're going to keep on a charitable model like we've been doing aid for 50 years. And that's achieved real results. But we need to accelerate them now. Other questions, comments? Please, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your talk. I think that I can see the major advantage of this program is that classically, I might be wrong, but classically, health-related funding comes in huge chunks to people who are very well established. An example is the NIH in the US and its equivalent in Canada. And I think that the NIH guys, people are realizing that this is not working. So I can see that this is a great program because I think the risk is not that high. You guys should take a higher risk as you give actually some numbers, right? So that's one thing. It's maybe a comment or a thought to share. Thank you. The other thing is that the business, I like the way you stressed on innovation also in business, not just innovation in technology. Because we're moving fast in so many ways nowadays. So companies know that if they're going to make money off something, they cannot depend on making money off that thing for many years.
Yep.
So they can make a profit from that thing and move on to something different.
Yeah.
An example is MRI machines. I mean, GE would not be interested in a machine that cost $500, a new MRI that costs $500 because they sell it for $2 million. But imagine if every little clinic has a $500 MRI machine. That's a feasible business model.
Yeah. I mean, that's Omar, you made so many good points along the way. I don't know which one to land on. Certainly, in terms of the idea of an ecosystem that has tons and tons of proof of concept projects, and you pick the ones that are really performing with the teams that can scale, that kind of innovation or venture capital approach, I actually think that improves the value for money of investments in innovation compared to the large $10 million, $20 million grants to Nobel laureates. So in the original Grand Challenges, three of the grants went to Nobel laureates. And some of those results were good. They got $20 million at a time. But it's a different ecosystem when you got hundreds and hundreds of these innovations, and they're going to young people, and they're going to anybody. I mean, you don't have to be a graduate student. You don't have to be a professor. You don't have to be in a university. We want to seek innovation wherever it is. It's a very democratic approach. So I think that creates a better dynamic and at least complementary to the $20 million to Nobel laureates. And I think it creates a very good dynamic for Canada. Remember, Canada's innovation productivity numbers could be better. So we have to think about, some of that is macroeconomics, trade deals, et cetera. And some of that is the microeconomy. And in the microeconomy, I'm a little careful here with Rohinton, an economic expert sitting here. But you know, in the microeconomy, the funding platforms and the arrangements amongst firms and institutions that are funding them, they matter. And so that's really the point where Grand Challenges Canada is really experimenting with different models. In a sense, we see ourselves as a laboratory for innovation, for different ways of organizing innovation in Canada and around the world, and continuously improving, defining different ways to do it. Your point about companies disrupting themselves, I was at the Lemelson Foundation, or not disrupting themselves, I was at the Lemelson Foundation 10th anniversary thing. They had it at the Smithsonian about 2 weeks ago. And the guy from Kodak, who invented the digital camera at Kodak and wasn't allowed to develop it at Kodak for 10 years because, well, God, it didn't rely on this whole film processing industry around the world. And that being delayed for 10 years is a good example of companies kind of being a little leery of disrupting themselves. But if you are a big company, you're far better off to disrupt yourself than to have someone else disrupt you. And so there's a whole dynamic there around disruptive innovation. And by the way, maybe the last point I'll make about this is something else I learned was, I used to think in the Gates Foundation mode, we're going to find like the one thing that's the home run. And they have had some home runs, eh? So the meningitis vaccine in North Africa, saving thousands, tens of that, that's a home run. I used to think we're looking for the home run. Actually, Grand Challenges Canada, if we're lucky, we'll get a home run. You know, we support an Ebola test, for example, at point of care. If that works out, that could kind of be a home run. We'll see. If we're lucky, we'll get a home run. But I actually think what we're doing is hitting a bunch of triples. And you know what? If you're in the sanitation business and you're supporting 10 social enterprises in sanitation around the world, and each of them is being kind of getting 500,000 users to be using toilets where they weren't using toilets before, I'm not sure it really matters that you didn't invent the best toilet in the world that scaled globally. I think it's probably okay that you're supporting 10 social enterprises where the innovation is in the business model in an embedded, culturally appropriate kind of way with different little tweaks on the toilet technologies. And before you know it, if you got 500,000 users in 10 social enterprises, you got 5 million users, and that's without even trying. And then if you double down on that, you know. So I think there's a way of thinking about innovation here too, which is maybe just hitting lots of triples, and if you're lucky, getting a home run, but not necessarily just going for that home run. And that's something else that I learned about how people think about innovation. Please.
I'm glad to see you're on the Blue Jays bandwagon. Continuing with the analogy.
Well, recently those would have been singles.
But. Yeah, sure. I think there's a bunch of grand slams to be hit in agriculture and use of biotechnology. So two questions. One, does Grand Challenges fund biotech and agriculture? And two, do you help, I don't want to call it the lobbying effort, but really the education effort about something that's socially sensitive? Around the world, there's a variety of opinions, obviously, about whether or not GMOs are useful or not, and hate to use a stereotypical example of golden rice, but you know, there's 500,000 deaths under five that could be prevented with a technology that was not made for a profit. And that's just an example of what can happen. Yeah. And it's being prevented from happening because of, again, social issues or activists who have different campaigns. What is your position on that?
Yeah, so we don't fund agriculture per se, but we do fund nutrition. So, you know, we funded, for example, a rice duck farming project in Cambodia or something, where through rice duck farming, you improve agriculture productivity. If you can make the link to human nutrition and human flourishing, then we have provided funding. So we have a very broad vision of global health. That's why we're funding these water technologies, right? Because water, sanitation, you wouldn't normally think about those in the context of global health, strictly speaking. But we are very interested in, we have been very interested to date in taking a very broad view to kind of learn and go. So I would say agriculture, no. Nutrition, yes. And sometimes the basis of that is an agricultural intervention.
And I'd say, and what's the difference?
Pardon?
I'd say, what's the difference?
Yeah, well, that's how you frame it, right? We look at it, we see if there's a human endpoint. Often it is a framing issue, but there are also agricultural things that aim only at productivity. We wouldn't fund those. There are things that aim only at, you know, climate resilience. We wouldn't fund those if the link wasn't taken through. But there are other organizations in Canada, and part of the game here is figuring out how this all fits together, like IDRC, where Rohinton worked, that have a very long and positive history of funding agricultural innovation, and recently with Foreign Affairs funded, I think, a $30, $40 million program in agricultural innovations, linking Canadian groups with groups in low and middle income countries. And but for calling it a grand challenge, that was a grand challenge in agriculture as far as I can tell. There's different issues about how much people like to use that word or not, but it was certainly development innovation. And since IDRC is funding agriculture so robustly and has such a long history, I don't think it actually makes sense for Grand Challenges Canada to go full hog there, if you pardon the pun, and we stick to nutrition. Now, on the GMOs side, it's a good example of integrated innovation. I know that Golden Rice Project very well, because it was one of the ones that was funded on the original Grand Challenges at like $10 or $20 million with Ingo Petroikas and the whole crowd. So I know very much at how the social tensions around GMO can impede the progress of technology and human flourishing. I wrote a piece in Nature Biotech about 10 years ago when I was a researcher, policy researcher, called Avoiding Franken-Drugs, which argued that we should avoid the same thing that happened in GMOs in agriculture, in health. So I understand what you're saying. I was also involved in a couple of projects that showed me how difficult this is, and to be honest, how ineffective scientists have been historically at really listening and understanding at what people are saying and getting to the root cause of the issues. You know, underlying a lot of those issues are not fear of GMOs necessarily and the risks, the environmental and human health risks. It has a lot to do with your views on intellectual property, has a lot to do with your views on multinational corporations, et cetera. And so I don't think scientists until recently have been very good at penetrating to the core of that. The early response to that has always been, I'm now going to tell you how good this is, and it's going to be successful for you. And that response just does not work in a pluralistic discussion. It has proven not to work. So your question was, does Grand Challenges Canada do that? Not really. You know, it's really we set the table for innovators to innovate. Would we fund GM? Sure, fund anything, you know, that's legal and that's regulated, as long as it gets to impact. We funded microbiome, we funded all kinds of things. But I don't really see it necessarily as our job to take on that particular battle. I did take on that battle when I was working on an ethics team supported by Gates to deal with the social and ethical challenges that were being confronted by projects in the Grand Challenges, but I don't really see that as being the goal of a funding agency which is trying to really achieve innovation with impact. But the questions you ask are really good and go to the social embeddedness of technology and go back to the core issue of integrated innovation in the first place and why you do need to think about the social, the business, the technological things right up front. And you know, Ingo Petraeus, he's a hero, but a hero who may not in his lifetime see the benefits of his work for the reasons you stated. So I understand exactly what you're saying, and just a little few reflections around that.
Thank you. My name is Jatin Nathwani, here at the University of Waterloo. And first, I want to thank you for quite a number of points that you made, which have complete resonance. So you began with focus on innovation, integration, moving away from silos, thinking about innovative business models that get to the needs and challenges of people who are essentially at the very bottom of the socioeconomic ladder around the world, the very poor and so on, and issues around health and health delivery and so on. We work in energy access, universal energy access, trying to get energy to these people. And we understand very clearly the precise linkages of access to energy through to educational outcomes, health outcomes, and I can go on. And what I wanted to ask you was to reflect upon this. I think you partly answered that question around the gentleman who was pressing you on how can you make money out of people who are very poor, or is there a business model there? The energy is a little more complicated than medical interventions because they're precise, you kind of know what you're trying to address and you get it. Energy is an enabler, really, in a very diffuse sense and what may eventually result in positive outcomes. But the challenge of innovation with energy systems and energy delivering the kind of outcomes to people in the poorer parts of the world is a deeper challenge than anyone understands. And where I was going to take you was, even after we get companies going, venture capital, funding some of these firms and moving away from a model that is, you know, government-funded development aid, is the supply chain of expertise that continues to support or would continue to support these businesses over the long haul to make them sustainable is a very deep challenge. Because you start with good intentions, excellent business plans, and they collapse 3 years later. Because you don't have the kind of chain of expertise to support that. If you might perhaps comment on from your experiences in this field as to what you may have learned, because that's an area we're moving into, beginning to realize it's not easy.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing I would say is I'm not an expert in energy. We have funded some energy projects, but they've always connected to health, just like the answer to agriculture. So we funded a project in Uganda on solar power powering operating rooms is an example. That one got in the Time top 10 thingamajig list. But you're asking a much deeper question. I would just point out that USAID has gotten more deeply into this, into funding energy innovations. It's obviously one of the sustainable development goals, so it's equally as important there. yeah, you'll find energy there, number seven. It's obviously linked to issues of climate, which has tons of support and funding, probably more than capacity to deliver that in the innovation space at the moment. But you were asking about the end models and the expertise in the supply chain to get to essentially to deliver energy to the point of where it's needed. And I'm not really in a good position to answer that particular question other than to say that those distribution models matter. We're here at the very front end of the innovation chain where we're thinking about nanocellulosic thingamajigs to filter out whatever from water, arsenic and everything else, or whatever we're filtering out from water. That's at one end of the distribution chain, of the innovation chain. You've pushed us now right to the other end of the innovation chain. You might think about it as the last mile in energy. We call it the last mile in health. And sure, I mean, distribution matters. Culture matters. We've funded some models that essentially are around business innovations in the distribution chain. In health, distribution channels matter a lot. Even the culture around distribution. I mean, just to give you one way out example, one of the projects we funded in Saving Lives at Birth was imams in northern Nigeria were providing very negative messaging around women and children. We identified, well, an NGO in northern Nigeria, we funded them. They identified those imams. They took them to El Azhar University in Egypt. They were exposed to more imams with different messages around women and children. They were better educated, informed, went back, and it was shown that their messaging improved and the rates of childhood vaccination in those districts in some pilot data improved. So that I think about that at the distribution end because, you know, right at the distribution end, at the point of use, distribution channel, there's also marketing issues. You could think about this as a culture and marketing intervention right at the very end of distribution and shaping consumers' attitudes. So that's it's not quite comparable because it's not pure distribution channel, but it is at that end of the chain. And I think you have to innovate wherever the bottlenecks in the chain are. And in the case of vaccination in northern Nigeria, that was clearly a bottleneck. There was a cultural bottleneck. And your point is that in energy distribution, to consumers, there's a bottleneck at that far end of the chain, and I accept that, not being an expert. And I think at each point you can innovate in the value chain, in the distribution chain, and we've just got to be smart about where we do it because the ultimate goal in your case is to get energy to as many energy poor consumers as possible in an affordable way. So totally understand, very much with you. Let me just summarize some of my key messages, then we'll call it a day. Number one, it's the people in this room and the young people in this university that are going to help drive innovation to achieve those sustainable development goals. Number two, we are here to help, and we'll help as much as we can in the context of the various constraints we have, like topicality and other kinds of issues, and we'll do it in a fair and thoughtful way. I mean, in some sense, the motto of Grand Challenges Canada is don't be stupid. Just really try and be thoughtful as you're innovating this innovation platform because our job is to enable innovators like you to succeed. Number three, what does success mean? It doesn't mean the coolest bauble. It means at the end of the day, you think about the end beneficiary and the woman deep in that Indian village whose life is going to be better or going to be saved as a result of your innovation. That's what innovation is about. Number four, there are a ton of barriers to get there, some of which were the market-oriented barriers. That was a very thoughtful question, especially if you're looking at sustainability. We don't care if it's a sustainable market from a private market or if we can convince a domestic government to be supporting innovation in a social sector and pulling innovation as opposed to maybe military spending or other types of spending domestically or corruption. I mean, these are all macroeconomic, global issues where we're trying to do a little bit of nudging, and they're very difficult issues. But at the end of the day, I guess my core message is that Canada can make a difference here. There is enough innovative power in Canada. There's enough of an innovative platform here that's been developed in consultation and in collaboration with other great Canadian institutions like IDRC and CIHR and, you know, the Department of Foreign Affairs, that if we actually all get our act together, we can provide a government as platform, and it's only a platform, because governments can only provide a platform. They can't actually do anything other than provide the platform for innovators like you to train private resources to really succeed in terms of end beneficiaries. And that's the global dynamic we're trying to set up. We're trying to have a role in Canada in doing that, and we're trying to do it to some extent with the Sustainable Development Goals in mind. It's a good time to do it, at least in Canada's niche area of maternal newborn child health, if not using models that are developed there to work in Canada or more broadly, assisting others to develop platforms that can really accelerate the attainment of some of these goals. And that's really what we're up to. And it's one has to be humble. You know, this is so difficult, and there's so much failure along the way. But we have to have a tolerance for that, and for learning on the platform. Just like you have to have a tolerance for failure and for learning in your innovation. The key is to be very disciplined. And at the end of the day, just to have two things in mind. Beyond everything, you know, what I encourage you to do is picture that one person at the end of the innovation chain that your innovation can help. Just picture that one person, and then figure out how many of those one peoples there are and how you can keep them getting benefit once your public funding is stopped. It's as simple as that. So that's one thing. And then the second thing, you know, for those that are civic-minded, I actually think this is a role that Canada can have globally, and a role that it is starting to have in a modest way with less resources than some of the other groups with whom it's working. And so what can be better than using innovation to benefit people who are vulnerable that you're picturing there and promoting Canada and its role in the world in the same breath? There's nothing better than that. And that's what we've been striving to do at Grand Challenges Canada. And more importantly, something that I encourage each and every one of you to engage on, because we're only here to provide the platform that allows you to succeed in doing so. Thank you very much.